Bismillahirrahmanirrahim. Our today's topic is others anti-protozoal drugs. It is continuation of your previous lectures such as anti-malarial and anti-MBSs. Protozoan parasites that cause human diseases are prevalent in underdeveloped tropical and subtropical countries where sanitary conditions, hygienic practices and control of the vectors of transmission are inadequate. However, with increased world travel, protozoal diseases are no longer confined to specific geographic localities. Because they are unicellular eukaryotes, the protozoal cells have metabolic processes closer to those of the human host than to prokaryotic bacterial infection. So many of the anti-protozoal drugs cause serious toxic effects in the host, particularly on those cells which show high metabolic activity. And yet most anti-protozoal agents have not been proven safe for pregnancy patients. Here is a clinical scenario. You have to think about it. A patient who is suffering from AIDS and is immunocompromised is being treated with multiple antiviral and immunosuppressive drugs. He develops an opportunistic infection by pneumocystis carinii. Which of the following drugs be most likely to use to treat the pulmonary infection caused by this protozoan? Here is the option. Let's move forward. Students, you need to wake up now. Your prof is not too far. Your core syllabus is just on an end. You should study. You should just get out of your comfort zone now and study hard. Assalamu alaikum. I am Dr. Neelofer Yusuf Varaj, your assistant professor from Department of Pharmacology. Here today our learning objectives are, by the end of the lecture you should know what is trypanosomiasis and how it is treated, what is giardiasis, what is trichomoniasis with its treatment, toxoplasmosis, cryptosporidiosis and other diseases such as babesiosis, plantidiasis, isospora, cyclospora and pneumocystis jeworica. Then in the end we will summarize. Trypanosomiasis. It is mainly caused by two different protozoans. One is T. brucei, which is also known as African trypanosomiasis and also African sleeping sickness. It is caused by Gambians, endemic in West Africa, and the other one is Rhodesians, which is endemic in East Africa. Protozoan is T. cruzi, and it causes Chagas disease, which is also known as South American trypanosomiasis, and it is endemic in South America. This is a diagram showing different stages of development of the protozoan tsetse fly, which causes sleeping sickness. And here is its stages which occur in a fly, and then how it enters in the human body and infected. And diagnostic stage is where the protozoan multiplies in the blood. Drugs for trypanosomiasis are for African are let me tell you one thing. It is also known as sleeping sickness syndrome. It is mostly caused by bite of tsetse fly. What happens? The protozoan firstly it just invades your bloodstream and body. Okay? Then it enters in CNS. When it enters CNS, it causes inflammation of brain and spinal cord, which leads to lethargy and eventually turns into sleeping sickness. Okay? Now for West American, when there is early CNS involvement, first line drugs should be pentamidine, enflonithine, and if there is resistance or they are not showing the therapeutic effect, then alternatively we can use suramine, amphlonethine, then comes melarspor. And for east of African, when there is early CNS involvement, suramine and melarsoprol can be used, and alternative drug can be pentamidine. ठीक है जी. साउथ अमेरिकन ट्राइपैनोसोमियासिस कैन बी ट्रीटेड बाय नाइफर्टिमॉक्स, बेंसनिडाज़ोल. नाउ व्हाट इज अफ्रीकन ट्राइपैनोसोमियासिस? इट इज स्लीपिंग सिकनेस. इट इज कॉज्ड बाय बाइट ऑफ सेट्सी फ्लाई. इट हैज टू स्टेजेस. फर्स्ट स्टेज इज हिमो lymphatic stage. What happens in it? Lymph nodes get enlarged, fever and headache is experienced. In second stage, there is meningeal encephalopathic stage, in which I said that CNS involvement leads to inflammation of what? Brain and spinal cord, and later on sleeping. So mental disturbances and drowsiness, and that's why it is called sleeping sickness. Chagas disease is caused by T. cruzi, and it is carried by infected triemtomine bugs which feed on human blood. It is endemic in South America, and it can lead to cardiomyopathy, megacolon, and megaesophagus. For treatment, we are going to use suramine. Suramine is a sulfated naphthalamine, and its structure. It was first introduced in 1920, and it is the first line treatment or drug for the early hemolymphatic stage of East African trypanosomiasis. ठीक है जी. It is also effective against Drusilla gambiens, but there is no role in American trypanosomiasis, that is Chagas disease. Its exact mechanism is not yet known. What do parasites do? They take up the protein bound drug by receptor mediated endocytosis. They damage intracellular structures, and it also inhibits trypanosomal cytosolic serine oligopeptidase, dihydrofolate reductase, thymidine kinase, and glycolytic enzymes. By inhibiting these, they inhibit their synthesis and further reproduction. They are not orally absorbed, and they can cause local inflammation if given subcutaneous or intramuscularly. Hence, they are only given intramuscularly. Complex pharmacokinetics and marked inter-individual variability. That means every other individual will have its own pharmacokinetics, like idiosyncratic actions. We don't know what happens. Each individual have its own metabolism. It has variable pharmacokinetics according to individual to individual. It is 99.7% protein bound. Its half-life is 41 to 78 days. It is not applicably metabolized. Its renal clearance is responsible for 80% of the elimination. And its penetration into CSF is also poor. What are its various therapeutic uses? It is used as first-line drug for pre-Prusai rhodesiens in early stage. It is also used in It is also being used in Gambians. ठीक है जी. So both African diseases they are being used. Given before melarsoprol to avoid reactive encephalopathy. No treatment until 24 hours of active disease. So rule out CNS involvement. Cautions in patients with onchocerciasis. Liver blindness or another parasitical disease for fear of Mazzotti syndrome. Here the question arises, what is Mazzotti's reaction? You should be knowing. The Mazotti reaction was first discovered in 1948, and it is a symptom complex seen in patients after undergoing treatment of nematode infestation, particularly with the medication diethyl carbamazine. And Mazotti reactions can be life-threatening as they are characterized by fever, urticaria, swollen and tender lymph nodes, tachycardia, hypotension, arthralgia, edema and abdominal pain that occur within 7 days of treatment of microfilariasis. Dose of sumerene should be given IV as 10% aqueous solution after a 200 milligram test dose. It is given on day 1, 3, 7, 14 and 21. That means you are not going to administer it continuously in children 20 milligrams per day on the same days. If we combine it pentamidine, it may improve its efficacy and it may give more good its therapeutic effects. What are its various side effects and toxicities? More serious immediate reaction is nausea, vomiting, shock and loss of consciousness, whereas it is rare, happens in 1 in 2000, hypersensitivity due to parasite destruction, malaise, nausea, fatigue are common. Most common problems after several doses are nephrotoxicity. As I told you that renal clearance is responsible for its elimination, most of its elimination, that is 80%. So we should be taking precautionary measures in renal failure diseases or kidney patients. So it causes nephrotoxicity, delayed neurological complications, and less common side effects are vomiting, diarrhea, chills, stomatitis, abdominal pain, edema, and in 8 patients it may lead to leukopenia, occasional agranulocytosis, thrombocytopenia, increased creatinine, increased bilirubin, and increased liver enzymes. That's why we were saying it should be taken with precaution. It should be it should not be given in renal insufficiency, patients suffering with renal insufficiency. So it is contraindicated in such patients and should be, and if taken, should be with proper precautions. Here comes pentamidine. Pentamidine is positively charged aromatic diamine, and it was accidentally discovered in 1937. It is a broad spectrum agent with activity against many protozoa and fungi and diseases related to protozoans and fungi. Its mechanism is also not known, exact mechanism, but multiple effects on a single parasite in different mechanism in different parasites. Transporter systems that are energy dependent, high affinity, they are destroyed, reacts with negatively charged intracellular organelles and leads to ribosomal aggregation. They inhibit DNA and protein synthesis in the protozoa, and they inhibit enzymes, and there is loss of topoisomerase 2 function. They also inhibit S-adenosyl L-methionine decarboxylase in vitro and plasma calcium magnesium ATPase. Their pharmacokinetics are more extensively studied in AIDS patients. They are well absorbed parenterally. Following IV injection, it disappears from plasma very fast with half-life of a few minutes to a few hours. Whereas elimination is vary from weeks to months. Its maximum plasma concentration after IM injection is, intramuscular injection is 1 hour. It is 70% protein bound. And it is also poorly absorbed orally. Do not cross blood-brain barrier, and if we take it through inhalation route, it causes less systemic absorption and further less toxicity. Its various therapeutic uses are being seen in T. prusai gambiens. It is given in early stages IM, and but it is ineffective in late stages. So they are only they can only be used in early stages in sleeping syndrome, sleeping sickness. Then it is also being used in leishmaniasis and other protozoal disease. We'll discuss it later. And it is also used in pneumocystis jirovecii. It is a very toxic drug. On intravascular administration, it causes hypotension and tachycardia. It also leads to hypoglycemia, which may be life-threatening sometimes. Paradoxical hyperglycemia due to pancreatitis, nephrotoxicity. On IM injection, it causes sterile abscess at the injection site, and other effects come such as rashes, anemia, neutropenia, thrombophlebitis, increased liver enzymes. Now comes the drug Merlisoprol. It was found in 1949, and it is used for late stages of trypanosomiasis. It is its structure, and it is the only drug still used for late stage East African trypanosomiasis. Its mechanism is also not well understood. Earlier, it was thought that it inhibits glycolytic enzymes, and it reacts with trypanothione and forms of merylsin oxide trypanothione compound, which competitively inhibits trypanothione reductase, the enzyme which is responsible for keeping trypanothione in reduced forms. It is always given intravascularly. Its half-life is 30 minutes. Their levels are small, but they are very therapeutically significantly anti-CNS. They are excreted rapidly, as its half-life is of only 30 minutes, and in feces 70-80% arsenic is seen. It is used for late stages of East African trypanosomiasis. 100% fatal if left untreated. It is also effective in early disease but preserved for late stages because of toxicities. On relapse, patients often respond to a second course. Earlier, very long schedules were used, but now there is a continuous 10-day course, not like suramine may having breaks in it. So it is continuously used for 10 days course of dose 2.2 mg per kg per day, and for Rhodesians it is still on trials and used for 10-day course. TKG. In this today, prednisolone is also given concurrently to reduce hypersensitivity, which is mostly during second or subsequent doses. So it is given along prednisolone. It can be asked in Vivo or MCQs. Its various toxicities and side effects are febrile reaction after injection, reactive encephalopathy, peripheral neuropathy, and that's why we were using prednisolone previously. I'm sorry, here you is missing of neuropathy. Vomiting and abdominal pain are common, and uncommonly it also causes hypertension and myocardial damage. Albuminuria is also present. It should be given only in hospital setup under proper supervision. During febrile illness, chances of reactive encephalopathy are more, so it should be given in proper continuous supervision, and it is contraindicated in G6PD deficiency, leprosy during influenza epidemics. Now comes the drug enflornithine. It is the structure of enflornithine. its mechanism of action is irreversible. It is irreversible inhibitor of ornithine decarboxylase and binds covalently, and it is also rate limited limiting step in polyamide biosynthesis. These polyamines are needed for cell division and normal cell differentiation of the protozoan. In trypanosomes, spermidine is additionally needed for trypanothione synthesis. So they can also inhibit human enzymes. Fibrosai rhodesiens is less sensitive, but there is more sensitivity rate to Brucei gambiens. So in rhodesiens, dose is increased 10 to 20 times more in comparison to gambiens. They are also given by IV route. They do not bind to plasma proteins. They are well distributed, and it also penetrate blood-brain barrier. If it is given with serumine, it enhances its penetration. CSF concentrations are also reached good to clear parasites and rapid renal clearance after IV injection, and more than 80% excreted is unchanged. It is used in late stage of West African trypanosomiasis. In children, doses are needed more. It is less effective in AIDS patient with trypanosomiasis. If it is treated with another antiprotozoal drug, nifurtimox, so it reduces the treatment duration totally. So there are a lot of advantages of this combination. Its adverse effects are common, but all of them are reversible, such as abdominal pain, headache, injection site reaction, tissue infections, and pneumonia. Reversible hearing loss is also seen after prolonged therapy with oral doses. And fluid overload is also present. Now comes the drug nifurtimox. It is a nitrofurin analog. It is effective against trypomesticot and amesticot forms of T. cruzi, also effective against Fibrosai, both in early and late stages. Here have a look on its structure. It is activated by NADH-dependent mitochondrial nitroreductase, which leads to generation of nitroradical anions. Trypanocidal effects are also seen. They are seen by a covalent attachment with cellular macromolecules. Further transfer of electrons from this activated drug leads to formation of native compound in the process forms free radicals. Parasites do not have catalase, and they use it from the humans. Well, they are absorbed well from by oral administration. Their peak plasma concentration is 3.5 hours. Despite this, very low concentration is found in plasma. 0.5% is excreted in urine. Elimination is 3 hours. High concentration of several unidentified metabolites is found. Their therapeutic uses are seen in Chagas disease, which was seen in where South America endemica. Markedly reduces parasitemia, morbidity and mortality. It is also used as parasitological cure in acute cases and 50% in chronic cases. It is also used in combination with N-flonathine for TB gambiens. These are various dosages and dosage plan, treatment plan used for age or different persons in adults, children. They cause immediate hypersensitivity. Delayed hypersensitivity is also present, GI problems and anorexia can lead to weight loss. Peripheral neuropathy is also seen. benzidazole. Benzidazole is a nitroimidazole analog. It is better tolerated than nifurtimox, in which we observe that there are more incidence of hypersensitivity reactions. Mechanism of action is same as that of nifurtimox. Half-life is 12 hours. Gastric upset and weight loss can also occur. And during its treatment, alcohol should be avoided as it increases the chances of side effects. So kids, this was our whole discussion about trypanosomiasis and its various treatment plans. Now we will lead to giardiasis. Giardiasis is a flagellate protozoan with flagella. Infection is caused by orofecal root. It can invade the mucosa and cause acute watery short duration diarrhea with foul smelling stools, gas and abdominal cramps. If it is just left untreated, it can progress to chronic diarrhea with greasy frothy stools. It is its life cycle in human body. What are the treatment plans? We will use metronidazole and alternatively we use tinidazole or secnidazole in it. For giardiasis, after metronidazole, nitazoxanide is also used, quinidone, chlor, paramoxine, furazolidone is also used. So I am repeating its treatment: metronidazole, nitazoxanide, quinidone, chlor, paramoxine, furazolidone is used for giardiasis. Now comes trichomoniasis. It is a microaerophilic flagellate protozoan which causes vulvovaginitis. बच्चों यहाँ पे याद रखो कि from here comes MCQ in your prof. It is sexually transmitted disease which affects 10% of sexually active women. Its typical presentation is intense vaginitis with purulent, greenish yellow, profuse, frothy, offensive discharge. There is pruritus, burning, edema, dyspareunia, and urinary frequency. Here is the life cycle showing how it affects the human body. Its management is, drugs are used mostly orally. Oral metronidazole is given. A repeat course is suggested after every 6 months. And partner should also be treated if there is frequent recurrences. Intravaginally, if there is, so we will treat it in refractory cases by dihydroxyquinone, quinidochlor, povidone, iodine. Now here comes another important disease in its treatment, drugs for leishmaniasis. There are two types, visceral and dermal. Visceral leishmaniasis is caused by Leishmania donovani. It is the carrier or the main cause of leishmaniasis is female sandfly, phlebotomus. There are two forms, in fly it is promastigote form, and in human it leads to amastigote form. It is mostly present in, disease prevalence is in tropical and subtropical regions. Currently used drugs are sodium stibogluconate, which is also abbreviated as SST, amphotericin B, which is an antifungal drug, meltefosine, paromomycin. Let's discuss them now. Sodium stibocloconate, STT, it was discovered in 1945. It is water-soluble pentavalent antimonial drug. Its mechanism of action is still unclear, but it acts on specific reductase enzymes, promotes efflux of glutathione and reduces thiol and leads to oxidative damage of the protozoan. It is rapidly absorbed and it is excreted in urine within 6 to 12 hours. A small fraction enters tissues and remains stored for a long time. Repeated doses may lead to accumulation of STT within macrophages, leads to prolonged inhibitory effect on leishmania. Its dose is 20 mg per kg daily and if given by intramuscularly, and its dose is IV injection for 20 to 30 days or more. The duration of treatment is adjusted according to clinical response. Patients are considered cured when no parasites are detected in splenic or bone marrow aspirates. Adverse effects seen in general with leishmaniasis with this drug are antimonials are toxic drugs, but the pentavalent compounds are better tolerated. Nausea, vomiting, metallic taste, cough, pain abdomen, pain and stiffness of injected muscles, sterile abscesses and mental symptoms often occur. Pancreatitis, liver and kidney damage, myelosuppression, ECG changes are possible but are seldom severe. Only few cases such as shock leading to death are recorded, but not so much. This is really, it causes death. Amphotericin B is also given. It is actually the drug of choice. TKG and like fungi, leishmania has high percentage of ergosterol. So presently, amphotericin B is the drug with highest cure rate in Kala-Azar. It is a disease also known as Kala-Azar. Up to 99% clinical and parasitological cure has been reported in STT resistant cases. Matlab ke jo cases which had become resistant to STT, they are treated with amphotericin B and more good results are observed. In fact, they are fully recovered with amphotericin B. Theek hai ji? High toxicity is also seen with amphotericin B and it and need for prolonged hospitalization, monitoring and repeated slow IV infusions limits its application. It is a drug of choice in pregnant and breastfeeding mothers. It delivers drug inside reticuloendothelial system in spleen and liver. So its dose is 15 mg per kg over 3 to 5 days. Then comes meltefusine. It is a derivative of alkyl phosphocholine. It is the first most discovered oral anti-leishmania drug. It is also first-line drug. Its mechanism is unknown. Phir bhi it is suspected that it interferes with lipid metabolism of parasite, or it may prevent synthesis of cell surface anchor molecules, or it alters signal transduction, which are all very important. It is rapidly absorbed. It is widely distributed. Its half-life is 7 days. Anorexia, vomiting, and diarrhea are seen as side effects. Skin allergy, raised hepatic transaminase, and also increased in rise in serum creatinine. It is contraindicated in pregnancy and its dose is highly 100 mg once daily for 4 weeks. Then come paromomycin. It is a aminoglycoside antibiotic. So its side effects would be related to aminoglycosides such as ototoxicity, elevated serum transaminase, and where it is injected, it's where pain is observed. It is effective, less expensive, and easier to use. For 21 days, it is used and intramuscularly. Dose is 11 mg per kg per day. Various combination therapies used in leishmaniasis are amphotericin B, miltefosine, amphotericin B and paromomycin, and miltefosine plus paromomycin combination is also used. Post Kalaazar dermal leishmaniasis patients are to be treated with liposomal amphotericin B and miltefosine amphotericin B deoxygenate. So these are the drugs which are used post Kalaazar dermal leishmaniasis. That was visceral, but we are talking about now dermal. After visceral, it may lead to dermal, where we will use amphotericin B, miltefosine, amphotericin B deoxygenate. This is something research related, updated variants. You should know it must be missing in your mini CADSON, but mini CADSON is not your suggested textbook. It is big CADSON, okay? So you are new generation, you should know the updated variants, updated information. So I have added this slide. There are some other alkyl phospholipids such as edelfosine and imofosine as well as perifosine, and they have proved to be more potent in vitro antiparasitic activity. In 2008, Carbera Serra, these were authors, they wrote in an article that edelfosine and perifosine, when they gave it orally in mice infected with leishmania amazonensis, what they saw that it showed perifosine had higher activity in vivo assay and may be a possible alternative treatment against cutaneous leishmaniasis. What is it? I'll tell you now. In 2008, a study was carried by Carbera, Serra and its colleagues. And what they did, they tested edelfosine and perifosine in mice who were affected with leishmania amazonensis. Okay? Unhone iski efficacy dekhi. और उन इस स्टडी में उन्होंने क्या देखा और क्या रिजल्ट्स थे, वो ये थे कि पेरिफोसिन जो है उसकी ज़्यादा अच्छी एक्टिविटी नज़र आई है इन ट्रीटिंग अगेंस्ट क्यूटेनियस लेशमेनियासिस. ठीक है, इस सारी कहानी का मकसद ये है कि हमने क्या देखा, पेरिफोसिन इज़ मोर पोटेंट अगेंस्ट क्यूटेनियस लेशमेनियासिस. These are some other studies carried out. Let's have a look. Cetamaquine is a promising oral treatment for visceral leishmaniasis in Africa. A 28-day course of treatment was efficacious and well tolerated in 61 Kenyan patients infected by leishmania with the tested dose of 2 mg. However, further studies are required to define the optimal dose. Some adverse effects included abdominal pain, headache and a severe renal event. The effects of cetamaquine on the kidney need further investigations. Now comes the dermal leishmaniasis. It is also known as oriental sore. It is not life-threatening. It is treated by local applications of the following drugs that are SSG sodium stibogluconate and paromomycin ointment, same drugs but route of administration is different as the disease is dermal. Now comes toxoplasmosis. Toxoplasmosis gondii is an obligate intracellular coccidian parasite. It was first described in 1908. While toxoplasma is derived from Greek word toxin, which means arc or bow, which refers to the shape of the parasite. ठीक है जी, ये बो की तरह की होती है, आपने देखा ही है ना तीर कमान, तो बो बनी होती है. Now recognized as the most common protozoan parasite globally with widest range of host spreads over containing over 200 species including birds, reptiles and mammals. ठीक है जी, अब जैसे कि है कि इट इज़ मोस्ट कॉमन प्रोटोजोन पैरासाइट नाउ ग्लोबली, तो एमसीक्यू इज सस्पेक्टेड फ्रॉम दिस टॉपिक, सो रीड इट केयरफुली. इट इज इट्स लाइफ साइकिल. व्हाट आर द वेरियस क्लिनिकल फीचर्स? दे आर लार्जली एसिम्प्टोमेटिक एंड सेल्फ लिमिटेड. अ स्मॉल परसेंटेज ऑफ पेशेंट्स मे हैव सिम्टम्स सच एज fever, malaise and lymphadenopathy. Retinochoroiditis is also seen in children but it is rare in adults. Myocarditis and pneumonitis is also seen but repeated abortion is observed in infected women. Its management is directly towards trophozoites mainly. In pregnancy we give spiramycin which is continued throughout pregnancy and monthly ultrasound to check for fetal abnormality. In congenital infective neonates, it is being treated by perimethamine, sulfadiazine and folic acid for 1 year. These are drug of choices and these are alternative drugs used for it. Primethamine doses for adults are 75 milligram daily, followed by 25 to 50 milligram, and these are the dose of sulfadiazine. And combination treatment is continued for 6 weeks. Then other diseases come as cryptosporidiasis. It is caused by coccidian protozoan found in intestinal drug, and it causes watery diarrhea. Its drug of choice is paromomycin. Nitrous oxide and alternative drug is azithromycin. Then come pneumocystis gyrovicae. It is found in lungs of many healthy individuals, but clinical diseases disease usually occur when the resistance is low. Here comes your MCQ or clinical scenario which are described in the starting of the lecture. So be careful answering it and have a look over here. Spreads by respiratory droplets. Drug of choice is cotrimoxolone. Alternatively, we give pentamidine, trimethoprim, tepsone, clindamycin, pramipine. Then comes babesiosis. It is named after babes who describe the intra erythrocytic parasite in the blood of cattle. It is caused by B microti divergence. It is tick-borne zoonosis, resembles malaria. Usually mild and self-limited, but can be swearing evil, fatal in asplenic and immunocompromised patients, and it is managed by clindamycin plus quinine in severe cases, whereas erythromycin atovaquone for mild to moderate diseases. Then comes balanitiasis. It is only ciliate protozoan known to infect humans. Zoonosis caused by B. coli. Infection is of large intestine that resembles MBSs, and it is treated by tetracyclines. Here comes Isospora belli, coccidium parasite that can cause diarrhea mainly in AIDS patients, and it is treated by cotrimoxolone. Cyclospora, it is another coccidium parasite. It is self-limited diarrhea in normal individuals, and chronic diarrhea is seen in AIDS patients. Then comes Microsporidia. It is spore-forming unicellular eukaryotic fungal parasite responsible for many diseases and roles in humans. Infection with Microspora or genus Encephalitozoon are treated by albendazole. In immunocompromised patients, infection is treated with fumagillin. Kids, here I'll suggest you to learn by heart the table given in your summary table given in your big caption. Don't ignore it. You should read it by heart. Now we'll summarize. Most of these drugs have been in use for years. Despite major advances in bioscience relevant to parasite biology, host defenses and mechanism of diseases. Satisfactory agents for treating important protozoal infections are still lacking. Development of drug resistance also poses a serious threat to better tolerated drugs in current use. Unfortunately, many of these diseases afflict the poor in developing countries. There is little economic incentive for pharmaceutical companies to develop new antiparasitic drugs. So scientists and physicians working in these fields must be creative and have turned to drugs developed originally for other indications. To investigational drugs made available directly from the Centers for Disease Control and Prevention or to agents developed for veterinary use to discover new antiparasitic therapies. The motto to say all these lines was that you are our future doctors, you are our future scientists. I just wish that you can work for poor and develop and after completing your studies, you should be able or you should have some interest to develop such drugs for such diseases which are not common and may help the poor. Okay? So this lecture was made from Basic and Clinical Pharmacology 14th edition, which is also known as Big Gadsden, Lippincott of Pharmacology, and help was taken from Google. So this was your today's lecture. Now coming back to clinical scenario. Here we said a patient is having AIDS and he is on many antiviral and immunosuppressive drugs. And on cherry on top, he developed opportunistic infection by pneumocystis carinii. So which should be the drug to treat such condition? Just think over it for a second. Now let's see the answer. The answer is E. As the drug of choice was not listed in the first line, drug of choice was not listed in the given list. So pentamidine is most effective in pneumonia caused by P. carinii. This protozoal disease usually occurs in immunodeficient patients such as those with AIDS. Nifurtimox is effective in trypanosomiasis and metronidazole in MBSs and leishmaniasis as well as in aerobic bacterial penicillins then infections. Then there was penicillins option. They are not considered drug of choice for any one of such disease or for this particular disease. This is a scenario, or this was the MCQ taken from your previous UH school. So be particular and learn from it. So this was your today's lecture, and I just want you to write various and protozoal diseases, infections, and their drug of choice in tabulated form. Tabulated form means you have to make a table. Theek hai ji, thank you so much. If there are any questions, you are freely to ask on one WhatsApp group or contact me on my personal number. Thank you so much. All the best. Allah Hafiz.